right. Well, I guess all that brings us to tonight. And the lecture topic is going to be attacking. And I'm assuming this is going to be more than one part kind of series. And we'll do a number of these attacking problems. Sort of as a reference, I'm using this Get Strong at Attacking book. It's a Richard Bozulich book. There are some things in it that I like and a lot of things I don't like. But, you know, we're going to use this problem exactly from this book. So if you like doing problems like this and thinking about the board, this is a recommendation. So anyway, this is one of the problems from the book, and it's black to play. And what do you notice? What has already caught your attention about this problem?
Well, it's a very weak white stone.
Yeah, there's this little guy, right? How often does this happen in your games? Where either you or your opponent has like one little stone just in the middle and no one knows what to do with it.
Not very.
Doesn't this never happens?
Yeah, it never happens.
Never happens?
It's very close.
Well, if it never happens in your game, that's probably a good sign. That's actually probably good, but I think for a lot of double-digit cues, this is a pretty common type situation. And the question is, for black, how do we profit by attacking this? Can we kill the stone directly?
I'm guessing the answer is no.
Really hard to kill it directly. Really hard.
I was going to say, is that the right question?
There's still, basically, we're surrounded on both sides, we can't make a base. But the problem is that we have no other real help in the middle of the board, right? There's a lot of places where white can get enough liberties to live, or get out, you know, make some sort of connection and be safe. So it's very difficult to kill this stone, but we can certainly harass it. And I think that's the idea of today. And how are we going to best harass this stone? What should we try? What comes to your mind? What comes to your attention? What do you want to do to punish white? White just played here. There we go.
It's getting heavier.
So, you say this, Jeff? Jeff?
That's my preference. Yeah. The one on top. Yeah.
One on top.
On top, because that looks to be the weaker corner.
This is the weaker side, although this one's also makes a nice box right there.
Yeah.
But you know what? I think we can do better than both of these moves.
I also kind of like this up on top. Just, I mean, the top. Like just playing out there and
just forgetting about it.
Kill it later.
Kill it later.
Because that gives you a nice double win.
Sure, this is how I would say it's playable.
I think we should force white to commit to that stone by making it heavier.
That would be nice, right? We should see if we can get white to commit.
To either touch it.
But drum.
Do we really want to attack? And at this point, is there not bigger moves left?
Attacking is pretty big.
Yeah.
And the reason why it's pretty big is that if white gets strong over here, we thought we had this whole side to ourselves, but now there's invasion points on either side. Mm-hmm. So if this stone ever gets strong, you know, white's still not really safe, but all of a sudden the whole side of the board we thought was really nice looking is a little less nice looking, or white still has a really nice looking side of the board and we can't make a strong group in here immediately. So, you know, I could see playing elsewhere as an option, but we're not. We're going to attack. Because it is really big, okay? It's really big. I would definitely say this. Like, if this was the situation, and it was black's move, and black played there, this move is very, even bigger.
Yes.
You know, making sure white can't take a base on our side of the board is even bigger. Now, attacking the stone, you know, maybe not. Maybe there are bigger moves. Maybe seeing how this side develops, we know exactly how to attack this hero could be very, very helpful. But again, what's today's lecture topic, John?
Attacking.
Okay, let's do that. So we have an idea for this. That's our first idea, courtesy of Jeff. What's our second idea?
Knight's move
from same direction.
Yeah. Or I still like the bottom side better. Yeah.
You like the bottom side now?
Well, I like the bottom side initially.
David says closer. How close?
Either touch it or shoulder.
So David says this or this?
Prefer the former.
Any votes for this?
No.
Any votes for this?
Maybe. Yeah.
John votes for this?
I'll vote for that.
So what do you like about this?
Well, there's potential threat to cut a lob, so it makes him respond, and you're kind of closing in on the one problem.
But if you're going to do that, isn't the shoulder better anyway?
Yeah, this is a bad exchange. This is a bad move for black.
Well, I prefer the shoulder hit, the ones you're doing.
This is better.
Yes.
But in this case, it's not the best.
come up from the other side.
I would say even better, but still not the best.
Yeah, okay.
But it is better. We are getting closer. Here's the first, I'll say, mini lesson of today's overall lecture. When we're attacking a group or a stone like this, you almost never want to touch it. Right? Getting too close is almost always bad. And there are exceptions, basically, when you're going to split white into two and cut them off immediately, but that's not what's happening here, right? One stone. Touching white is bad. White has a weak stone, stone in trouble. Do not, under any circumstance, touch the stone. So when David plays this, I'm just picking on you because you offered it. Where does white play? What happens?
One side or the other.
Yeah, and actually, not only that, in certain situations, white can even do this. Alright, and this gets really annoying really quickly. Because white will play somewhere over here. It's hard to hold a book and a stone at the same time. And white, you know, depending on the position of this stone, if this is on third line, that'll help a lot. White might even be able to just crawl around and make two eyes almost immediately. Not our ideal result. But that being one option, certainly this is a nice looking move. And actually, I'd probably cut on this side if I was white. Where does black play?
Cross cut.
Yeah, cuts. But now, what does white get to do? Yeah, we take the Satari, but should extend. We could say, no, I want these points, right? But, yeah, you got a couple points, right? White got a lot stronger. This is good shape, right, from last week? 2 weeks ago, and the week before we talked about this? So we got to extend, but then white gets to connect. And now these three stones are actually a lot stronger. They're so much stronger, not just because there are three stones that are connected, and you know, collectively they still have only four liberties, but because now black is that much weaker, right? See this stone right here? This is a much more difficult stone to protect now. This stone needs help. Likewise, see these two stones? These only have three liberties. These two stones might need a little bit of help. Just because of these two weaknesses now, white will have no problem escaping, crawling around, doing whatever white wants to do. Okay, so in this case, touching was a disaster. We took a position where white was very weak and basically gave white a bunch of our own weaknesses for white to use against us. We want to avoid that. So whenever we're attacking like this, we need to play a little bit further away. So we have to avoid making weaknesses intentionally in our own group. So I'm going to, for basically all of today's lecture and probably even a little bit of the next lecture we do attack, it won't be next week again because we have the professional coming next week, but maybe the week after, there are three basic moves we're going to look at when we're attacking a group like this. Yes, we want to look at the shoulder hit. That's one. Two, we want to look at the knight's move. This both chooses a side that we want to develop and puts pressure on white. And number three is the cap. And this move, Jeff's idea of jumping, was pretty good, except my problem with it is white just comes to. Right, and while we got white to respond, now we're getting weaker. We just made ourselves weaker, and we don't... I mean, what's your next follow-up? To play over here? Well, if we play this way, white's out, white's never going to be weak again. We've gotten our two free moves from attacking. That's good, right? Look, free move, that's great. But we're never going to get anything else out of this, at least for a little while. Unless we get something else strong over here. White's too far out already. So this is not quite enough pressure. We don't want to let white out that easily. And that's why we're going to play one of the three attacking moves. Shoulder hits, knight's jump, and cap. In this case, I'm going to show you the correct answer first. Okay, and then we're going to work our way backwards and then compare that way. Okay, so you know what we're going after. This is going to be the correct move.
Okay.
That's funny looking, or?
No, it's okay.
It's okay. So, let's say your opponent does this to you and you're white, what do you want to try?
Choose one of those two to get in between.
Yeah, there's really only two moves, right? We can run this way and we can run this way. Usually you want to run more to the open side. Just want to run that way. Now the next move is the move that I hope that, you know, you guys, especially after today, you learn this move, because this is the move you guys don't know. Right? You've seen the cap before, you've seen the shoulder hit, you've seen you know, the knight's jump. You've seen those before. But this is the move that I watch your games, you know, after we do this lesson. This is the one you guys don't know instinctively. Okay? Does anyone have an instinctual place for black to play here? Or is it just like, I messed up, white's going to destroy me?
I think black needs to protect the stone on the third line.
Okay, so where do you play?
Extend to the left from that.
So, left here? But then white plays here.
Well, you were kind of resigned that white's going to get out anyway. So, no.
I like the diagonal up from that one that you played. So a nice move from that stone.
This one?
Over to left one.
This?
Yeah.
Better,
but it's easier for white to get out.
Right here. This is a really cool move. What do you do, black?
Sweet.
Actually, you should probably just play this and then that. I think you should make the I'm not sure what the correct order here is. Actually, you shouldn't play this, but I'm going to show you how it's worked, because this is a really cool shape, at least. Okay. White should play one other move first. So if we cut here, we play here. And what does white get?
Gets to eat a
stone. That's an eye. That's super helpful. How about if black blocks this way? Now we're in white play.
I've got to try to connect. But if he tries to connect diagonally, you're going to cut him off.
Yeah, and that's good. That's great for black.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but if we play this,
I like that.
If we cut off here, we need a stone over here. Now, but here's the thing, we shouldn't actually play this stone before we get black to commit. So this is actually bad timing. It's the correct shape point, but it's the bad timing. It's an advanced shape. So anyway, here's the moral of the story. We're on the right track, very interesting move, but we're actually helping the wrong stone. The stone that needs help isn't this one.
Oh, it's the captain's stone.
Yeah, it's actually this stone.
Yeah.
So if we play here, what's the problem? This is a bad move. This is what I see you guys playing your games.
Yeah, white eats the...
White goes here. And black goes, I meant to do that. Does this.
No.
Don't eat me. And white goes here. And black's like, actually, a lot of times black will play here. Even though that's worse, don't play this. Because now you just give white another forcing move there. Right? Atari, descend, capture two stones. So if you're going to play that, you have to play that. But then white just goes, I'm out. These two stones look stupid. Not great. So, I want to know the move.
I'm going to go with the knight's jump off of that lovely stone. Yeah, okay.
That's the move. This is a sweet move. This is very, very common. When your opponent splits your elephant's eye like this, this can be in the middle of the board, this can be the side of the board. Often the move is the knight's jump off of one of these stones. These are the two key points here. So white wants to run this way, we want to keep white low. And the problem here for white is that white actually has a hard time dealing with this stone. Like, the stone is hard to capture immediately. If white just plays a simple move, like this, black can respond with a very simple move. How about that? Is white out yet?
Almost tied.
All right, let's keep going. How do you get out, white?
Well, you'd either jump or go diagonally up and left.
Like diagonally that way?
Yeah.
Well, can I do that?
I mean, essentially, it's sort of like a ladder. You threaten to run them down to the edge.
It basically is, yeah. And we're just moving, notice we're moving white into our strength. Right? We're just keeping our distance, moving white into our strength. Notice this is another knight's jump, right? Another go up two and over one. Right? Very nice move for attacking. Especially when we're in these running kinds of attacks. This is the type of move. Because white can cut us if white wants to. But white has to waste a tempo doing it. So if white tries to cut, right, if you know there's a weakness there, white says, aha, I cut you. And you go, good luck with that. Now you have a weak stone over here, and you still have your problem. So white isn't easy to cut this either. Surprisingly strong. This gets really scary for white. Real quickly. Maybe white has to play something like this. And depending on, actually kind of, if nothing else is there, I think there's actually a couple options, but I think that's probably good enough. White will just come out and do something like this. You get a free corner. Oh man. Has white gained anything yet?
Liability.
It still has a liability. What has black gained?
Corner
and pretty nice, you know, influence. Black right now is controlling the middle.
White still has another direction to go.
So David at this point says, this was terrible, let's go that way. Alright, David, attack this.
Well, I'm just thinking, if the same thing happens, isn't this black on the inside going to get cut off?
Where? How?
All these black stones sitting on the inside. Oh, we're going to make light.
Oh, I messed up the, that was a knight's mount. No, that was supposed to be there. No. Something like that. All right, so you go that way. I go there. Now what? It's really hard.
No.
I mean, now you're just going to solidify this black corner and give black more central influence, and... Still not quite be 100% alive. And not only that, if black gains any one extra liberty somewhere over here at any point, you know, with a move like this or this, there becomes this cut.
That's what I was wondering at. But I was also wondering, right. I think you just mentioned the answer there, but I think the problem with that is maybe you're not quite ready to do that.
Yeah, I mean, this right now is right. You have to pick a direction and go as white, right? Because you're still leaving this weakness. You haven't, by doing this, you've only helped black. You have not helped white yet.
Yeah.
Right? Now, if you can get over here and live, great. Done. Okay? Then come over here and invade or reduce somehow, somewhere else. But if you can't live this way, you have to go that way. And if you can't live that way, you have to go play somewhere else on the board. Right? The attack is too severe. Now, do you guys see how severe of an attack this became? I can't emphasize enough to you guys how potent this combination is.
So why won't white just sacrifice the stone and reduce from the outside?
He kind of has to. Right? But what would you rather have? Would you rather have white there and threatening to invade your bottom on either side? There or there? Right in there? Or would you rather say, go play somewhere else, white, it's mine. So, I mean, the choice is yours. But, again, the really important combination is when white splits you like this. This is how, one of the reasons how Q players just fail at attacking, is then they push white from behind here. Those are terrible moves. You need to knight to move and jump ahead. You need to get in the area where white wants to go before white gets there. Don't think you just need to push white directly. Okay, knight to move. Sweet. You guys are still taking it in, that's good. Alright, I'm gonna move some stones around here. Let me actually get out my page. I have another problem we'll look at a little bit different. Let's go there. This time we're actually gonna give white a base. So we'll be nice and say, white, you get a base. And all that's the same. Alright, a little bit different this time. A little bit different. That's supposed to be there, I'm realizing now. Not a huge difference. All right. What are your ideas for, here's the question. Can we still attack white? Is it possible?
You can always attack.
You can always attack, sure, yeah, all right.
I guess, but should white be afraid of dying is the question.
I guess that's more of a question. What's black's move anyway? Right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, black's move.
So I would think that to think that one can attack and kill it would be wrong, but maybe to attack and make profit is the consideration.
Yeah. So how can we profit from this?
Knight's moved in from, what's that, 17-8?
From which side?
Yeah, right there, yeah.
This one?
Yeah.
That's like pretty close. I mean, this idea works. Let's say white plays here. You gonna respond again?
Haven't decided.
This makes white very happy, actually. Because if you peek now, who has better shape here?
What?
Actually, white. These three are better than these two and up. I don't know, tail, even tail. Right. So peeping, white's gonna be quite happy. Because you're actually making it harder for white to attack, for white to be under attack later. Part of this problem, at least how the book portrays it, is black wants to keep white unsettled. White thinks white has a base. Let's even change the problem to this. Your job as black is to not let white have a base.
It's
kind of
a big area.
It is a big area, right? Look, you guys know, two space extension, right base, done, right? You're safe, sort of.
Well, yeah, safe, sort of.
Safe, sort of. Now, well, this is what we're investigating, the right?
We still intend to seal light in, or threaten to seal light in.
We just want a profit. We are being very flexible. We just want a profit.
Since we just looked at a cap, I'm staring at the cap now.
Sure. There's two caps though. Which one do you want to try?
The one on top.
The higher stone.
Okay, so why this one?
That's the side we want to develop.
That, and I feel like I'm a little stronger at the bottom.
You're a little stronger at the bottom, right? So if white lands out here, you're, you don't mind white getting strong over here, right?
I mind it less.
You mind it less, yeah.
Well, doesn't that look white run diagonally up?
Same problem, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we know how to do this now.
Now, yeah, if you want to just take the center influence, you guys can go back to this move, right? And say, I just want the center influence, I'm done. But this isn't actually keep white unsettled. That's sort of the problem with this move, is that white might actually have other plans for us. And I'd like to show you one of those plans. I didn't show you this move. This is kind of an advanced Dawn level kind of move. Here's a Tsuji here. It's pretty cool, Tsuji.
I think the difference between this and what was studied before is, in this case, white already has a potential base.
White already has a potential base, so if white runs, white can just try to make mischief like this, right, immediately. And you guys see the problem with this? Black goes up, white can go here. Are you going to let white out?
Maybe.
Okay, and let's go this way. Are you going to let white out?
Yes.
No. If we're not, this stone was really useful then.
Yeah.
Alright, because now we just trap these two stones. So this is a Tsuji. Okay, your Q players won't know this move. And if you play it, they'll just be confused for about 5 minutes and then play a move eventually. So here's the thing though. You know, in this case, this still might be a good enough result for black, quite frankly. I mean, this is still an appropriate attack. But if we really want to make sure white is running forever, white is a liability for many years, many moons to come, we want to take away white space. And the moment to do that is right now. And similarly to how there's two shape points over here in this shape, right, we have the elephant eye. This is the elephant eye jump, right, and white splitting it. There's two shape points over here. There's also a shape point on the other side. Totally looking at that.
I can read.
This is after the cap?
This, yeah, so cap, white runs,
right.
Black can play this immediately. This is another very cool shape point. This is why I think attacking for Q players is so hard, is that, yes, you guys might be able to, at the level where you can read a few moves in advance and kind of have an idea of what you want, but for some of the classic attacking shapes, there are just some key points that you have to just sort of know and instinctively look at and see how well they work. All right, let's try it. Let's see what happens here. Okay, where does white play?
Straight coming down.
coming down, you say?
Yeah.
That's glorious. We actually have multiple options for black, depending on what black wants to do at this point.
Just go under that.
We could just link up our stone. That's pretty good.
Pretty good, you just took away his base.
We did. Right now, White's going to be running and...
He could run a little faster than he could in the previous time.
Yeah, he'll be able to get out, but he has no base, right? Remember how he played two moves down here to make sure he had a base? Nope, no base. Not going to happen. The other thing we could do, and this would be a more of a special circumstance, what if we don't mind White living right here, but I really want to cut this off. What if I have big potential over here? Say all this is black, and I don't know, maybe White has a stone over here, so if White runs, I don't know. For whatever reason, I just want to cut this stone off. I want to take all this as mine. Well, oops, they're in the same move. I can play here. This is a pretty cool move, too. You say, White says, what gives? I kill you. Right? You die.
Now you made it small on the side, yeah.
Yeah, now you cut. White goes, oh no, my stone! But then, you get all of this. You just cut through that base. So White says, no, I take that back. I kill you. You say, that's great, Atari. Cut over here. Now White, you know, White doesn't do something, White's gonna get captured. So White has to play one more move. You can even take another Atari. And now if, you know, there's really no other friends, first of all, you cut off this stone. You have a strong outside group. This group, not as strong. If White runs, there might be some danger points in here. But White only has one eye. Get running, White. You thought you were going to make a nice safe base by capturing my stones, but you totally didn't. So if we're okay with giving White one eye, this is a very playable sequence.
Well, at this point, White can move towards the center.
Sure.
Well, I'm thinking more just straight out.
Like this?
Yeah.
This doesn't make eye shape, though.
Well, I'm thinking like getting out, but it's also a threat on those three stones.
On these three?
Yeah. Isn't this maybe starting to form
a... Yeah, but if Black already has influence over there, I can just play things like this.
If he had that.
Yeah.
But I'm saying without that, doesn't White have a credible...
Sure, but you still have eye shape. Right, if you're crawling like this... probably fine. You know, now I'll go over here and take this. I feel like Black's still pretty happy.
Yeah.
You know? This wall isn't doing a whole lot, right? Black's corner is pretty safe and already has an extension from it. So, it's not that White can't do it, I'm just trying to be efficient while playing White, and making a wall facing already a pretty strong Black group doesn't really help us enough, right? In fact, it helps Black too much. Black gets a couple free moves over here.
Moral is, I guess, that it's not the end of the story to say, well, White can run away. It's that if he's only got one eye...
We're just trying to... He has to run away then, right?
And you keep hitting him, you're making profit.
Yeah, look, we got this, right? This was for free. We cut off this stone. We got these for free, that for free, that for free. It's all free. It's like all free. I guess this was Gote, right? Because White was out by then. So, this is the one move we actually paid for with a move. Everything else is free.
Ripped
up. So, again, let's go back to the original position. This is off. If we cap and White pokes, there are three key points you need to know in this shape. Bam, bam, bam. They're all amazing.
Does the shape include two White stones?
This?
No, those two, the split deal.
Yeah.
So that's why that one's key point, because there's the other White
stones. Yes. Yeah. Yep. So when you have an elephant eye and your opponent splits, but this is a really common shape in Go, right? This is why we can play the capping move, is because once white plays here, we have three other key points for us to play. All right, I'm gonna change the sequence a little bit. What if white does this? Is this a problem?
As long as you respond, just bring the black up.
Just connect up, right? Upwards.
This is better.
That's better?
Yeah, and now...
What happens here?
You get a little bit, yeah, you're a little bit short.
White has more options here.
Yeah.
You know, white can see where this goes first, and then come back and start to make an eye shape over here. Right, because this will be Sentai. The problem here, of course, is that black can play this and threaten that cut, so it's not entirely Sente if white needs this connection. But white doesn't really need to respond here again. Right? White later on can play other moves. If we play this way, white can still play those other moves, but what happens to this potential eye shape? There's nothing, right? Like, it's very hard to get an eye here without capturing these two, and you can't capture these two stones. So this is the shape point here. When white comes on top, take away the potential for an eye. Again, you're attacking, right? Don't let white get eyes. This gives an opportunity to white to make eyes. Okay, minor difference. Okay, but in all your games, right, we've now seen two examples where, if as long as you remember what happens when white does this, as black, you can play these capping moves. Right, when you have these, you guys are generally scared of these diagonal jumps, right? Because you guys are level, right? You can read three moves, you guys are that good. You play this move, and white goes there and you go, aw. Right, and this is why you guys like to play stuff like this.
Yeah.
This is no good. White goes, really? Okay. Happy. Not a severe attack, right? White safe. But if you know these key points, that's the new move in your arsenal today. Feeling good? Feeling powerful. I want to kill stuff. Here, let me set up a new problem. I'm going to find my page again. All right, I'm going to find, this one, especially if you've been here, if you were here last week, I don't know, last week was the 4-4 week, right, 2 weeks ago was the shape, yeah. If you remember, we're going to do a 3-4 corner, but if you remember the concept from the 4-4 lecture, you should be able to find the answer to this problem. So I'm gonna change it around the board a little bit. Make that a 3-4. Put that there, put that there. We'll give black a 4-4 corner. Give white some 4-4 corners. So white came over here, ducked in the corner. And white did this. That's it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, I'm missing a stone. More stuff. There we go. So how'd this happen? Well, black made high Chinese opening, right? That formation. And then white approached, black played here, white played here, and black played there to take another big point. And then white said, oh my god, look at all this. Black plays here. Yeah. Double wing formation, Moyo territory, everything. Oh my god. Can't do that? So you have to play here. Your move is to decide what to do as black. White just totally played the spot you wanted to play.
Well, try number one. It's based on last week. If those two stones were then what you would do is you would touch the white stone.
How would we touch the white stone?
The third line, yes, underneath there.
Very good. Nicely done. Exact same concept. So why are we now, we just said don't touch a weak stone, right? We said that. Do you guys remember like 20 minutes ago maybe?
Right.
We said don't touch a weak stone.
But you're strong this time.
Your argument from last week was that if you touch that stone, now it's something that white has to defend, and you've got it, you're attacking from both sides, and now you can go, he doesn't have a base, and you can go hit on him.
Yeah.
Some good things will happen.
We already control all the surrounding positions. Right? Like, we got stone here, we got stone here, we even have more help over here. We need to make this worth more. If we just play some really nice loose move, white might say, you know, that stone, you can still kind of live if I really need it to. I'm going to go play somewhere else. black doesn't actually have an ideal move to punish this. Then you're going to end up playing something like this again anyway. And white goes, haha, I made you play two moves.
So it's really not as weak as it looks.
The white stone? The stone's, I mean, yes, it's weak. But if you're white, you're thinking, hey, I can go in the corner. I can go out, and I can go this way. It's pretty hard for black to harass this. There's a lot of different ways I can get eyes.
But you're also, since you got a good chance of keeping them in there, you're also over-concentrating, is that it?
Over-concentrating black?
No, over-concentrating white.
White has one weak stone. This cannot be, by definition, over-concentrated.
Oh.
Like, over-concentration basically has to imply that I played two stones voluntarily that ended up too close together.
Yeah, but I thought that's what you're kind of forced weight to do.
Well, that was the corresponding point last week, was that if the stone on the middle handicap point was white.
Right.
So move it down. Yeah.
There we go, that one.
Something like
yes,
that.
Yes, this one.
Now if you hit the white stone and he responds in that natural way.
This is what I think this is what you're thinking of.
Okay, so our situation now is different.
Right, because in this case, white played two stones voluntarily, right?
Yeah.
Therefore, we can make them over-concentrated.
Yeah.
You put two stones that are close together, we can show them. You put two stones that are close together. You're stupid, right? You should have put those farther apart. In this example, before I move the stones back, white hasn't put two stones in. We're not making any white over-concentrated at all. He only has one stone in here. We're trying to basically fatten up the turkey before we eat it.
Yeah,
is really what we're doing. Or we're trying to, even more importantly than that, we're trying to restrict the directions that white can go. So even though this makes a weak shape for us in the corner, right, this is not the best corner shape, and white has a wall here, white now has invested two stones, double the points, and is going making eyes here in the corner an option?
Not anymore.
So we've effectively removed one of the three ways white could go in Sente. Yes, we have made white a little bit stronger, but again, we're fattening the turkey. And so for the exact same reasons, when we have stones like this, this is when it's okay to touch a weak stone. Okay.
Does it depend on that center stone being on the fourth line? The center stone, we're on the third line, not that one, sorry, that
this
one.
This one?
Yes. Oh,
you can do this here, but it's better here.
Okay.
And the reason is because when white does this, you kind of have to respond over here, otherwise white will crawl around you, and you don't want that. So we can play something like this, or like this, or like this. Probably with a stone here, we're okay to play this, but this one leaves a big glare and weakness here and here. If you're a little more patient, you can play here. But if we play one of these, white can just run like this, believe it or not. And if black says, hey, you're not connected, well, I don't care that I'm connected. I can actually lean on your group over here and become connected if I really want to. When the stone is here,
yeah,
it's a little bit harder to run out. It feels like we have to be a little more committed to trying to make eyes.
Yeah.
And that can be very difficult. Even if white does this, if the position is as it is right now, we probably just want to play something very simple like this. And if white plays here, we can just do this. Say, how many eyes do you have?
One.
Right now, only one, yeah. White has to play like this.
But if somebody else is white, they might have one or two.
Yeah, depending on the players. I think this is the move to give white best chance of making eyes. But I think we can still just harass it very simply. This something. White's not entirely comfortable yet. I think white still at some point needs to find a move like this, or that's it. Still not guaranteed. Not guaranteed. That's only one eye.
This point, put on the third line.
Third line. If black plays here, what do you do?
Well, yeah.
No eyes?
Just come down with white.
You can make one eye and go take.
Oh,
mind. I thought I saw something else. Maybe I saw a triple H in there.
Still tough. Tough. He's still running. And, like, this is a great exchange for black, right? This got nice. And we still have our corner. It's not like white invaded our corner. White's on the run. Profit. Feeling good. So this is the one time when we're so strong, we want to touch white, so we were restricting white's movements. That first example we saw, we didn't want to touch white because white was already restricted to movement, right? White didn't actually have anywhere white could go. In this example, white does. Okay? Cool. Let's do another one. There's definitely one more major concept I want to introduce today, and I think it's in the next problem I want to show you. It is this one. So, I'll still have this be black's side of the board. That's going to stay there. That back. Give white some 4-4s. Black will split. And at some point during this game, black started attacking this group. Very exciting. And I think that's the position. Alright, looks good. So at some point, black started attacking this. Notice both players, instead of building up their cells, they've decided to split each other. It's that type of game. White approached down here, white approached over here, and black's, maybe white didn't quite make a base over here, so black came back and attacked over here. What do we do now? That's black. How do you read the board? What's your analysis? What's strong, what's weak?
Looks like black is weak.
Not much is strong.
Yeah, I mean, there's still an invasion point in this corner, right? So this corner actually still has some issues. White can play in there at any time, and black goes, oh, no. If you just block over here, we crawl around this way. If you block over here, white might just leave this for later, for a little bit longer yet, just before he decides what to do with it. But they're moved like this, or like this, or like this. More like this, where white can actually take away our corner later on. So this has got to be in the back of our minds. How about these two stones?
White has a nice extend and attack move.
Yeah, like something like this. Right, we don't have a base. I mean, they're not weak, but they don't have a base yet. So something else to kind of keep in mind. We want to make sure they don't get weak. This stone, is this stone okay?
It's okay, because if white attacks either side, you can extend to the other.
Beautiful,
side.
Right? White attacks from either side, no problem, right?
That's
we're fine.
The case with the white stone, this side.
On this side, white can still extend. White can, here's the thing, even if we play this, you know, white doesn't necessarily want to do this, but white can play some moves in here.
Okay, that move you might get.
You know, and we'll make something.
Okay.
Or, if we really just wanted this, we play the one space jump, makes an eye. So, you know, we can start to get a base, and I can make a lot more than one eye, too.
That sounds like a proper one space jump makes an eye.
Not always. I'm not going to guarantee that. But in this case, it can.
That's right, you can jump farther into the underneath those.
We could always play this move. So yes, this move will hurt white, but there's still enough room to wiggle around. It's not ideal, right? Ideally, we'd want to play that, right? Two space jump, best solid base extension. We'd be a little more creative in these circumstances, but still possible. And this one's even more flexible, right? Because if white does this, two space jump, or actually, this is a case where you can actually play a three space jump. And there's some Joseki that come out of this that maybe we should spend a whole class talking about, but if this ever comes up in your games, it might not be worth doing. But this is a very, very common kind of pattern. Even in professional games, this happens a lot. But we won't talk about that, all right? You see how this stun is very flexible. How about this? These two?
They already have a base.
Already have a base. And then, how about these three?
Aren't they pretty much as good as out?
They look pretty out, right?
And if you try to do the knight's jump coming down, try to drive it to the wall, there's a white stone up here. There. They head for the white stone on the side.
This white stone? Yeah, but I'm also just seeing that there are potential problems in black shape too. There could be a cut here. This sort of looks like a fight, but white has a friend.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Black can kind of try to drive white, but he's going to drive them into a friend, so.
Yeah. We really would like to attack these three, wouldn't they? There's no base. I mean, they're out.
Cap.
Yes, it was cap. Aggressive. Okay, white does this.
Try it.
Knight's move, right? Unfortunately, this stone is not in the right position.
Yeah.
What's happening to these two stones?
Without the other one.
And there's still this problem here. Capping is a little bit too thin in this position. So we need a new go lesson, right? This is the new concept we're introducing here. This will be the final concept for today's lesson. Oh, you're right. We do want to attack this.
Shoulder hit?
Which one?
On the right.
Yeah, I would, if you're going to make a shoulder hit, I would do it on the right because I'm cutting off the white stone below, but I would also do it on the left because my stones on the left are weaker. I'll do it on both sides at the same time, and it will work.
But at this point, you make your move further to the left up there.
Yes. That's the one that should do.
What'd you say, John?
I say, like, you do the shoulder hit.
This one,
on the right.
Okay.
Like you were saying, and then white does something here.
Yes.
Okay, and then maybe this is a good time to do something like 6 or 7-3 or something at the top.
That's black?
Yeah.
It's black. Oh, yeah, you want to not become weak over here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because this is both straightening that up, is also pushing
this,
on the corner.
Or this white is just going to do stuff down here. White's going to ignore that. And white's still safe over here, and now white is going to eat more of your points over here. And really interesting problem.
What is team two doing? Like, start giving...
This?
13, sorry.
Oh, 13. This?
That's just white, you start giving a mini base. And then maybe...
Oh, this isn't there yet. This weakens your corner even more, though, right?
Yeah, you might decide to do that as a preliminary to something. It helps the group on the left a little.
You don't know if this needs help yet or not, though.
Right.
We don't know yet. It's too early. Too early to be sacrificing our corner. Davis's wedge. I do think it is too crazy to think about. There's actually a very easy sequence here. Black plays here. White plays here. You didn't do anything. Except you actually made white a little bit stronger now, because now it has two stones facing out. Not effective.
But the alternative is to peek. Well, again, that's just sort of
that just makes light
sound. Alright, your minds are about to be blown, guys.
Okay. Say again?
Your minds are about to be blown. You ready for the move? I'm going to attack this here.
So that's attacking towards the top.
Yeah. When we were running white out, we noticed you guys said, oh, but white has a friend.
Cut the friend off.
Yeah.
But you haven't really cut the other group off, so you may have cut the friend off. The friend can still respond a little bit.
This? Where are you going to respond?
Fourth line.
You go up here?
Yeah.
I think...
If the friend lives, I think black gets strong around it and lets you the three stone group a little harder.
Yeah, but I'm thinking that maybe as white gets a little bit stronger there on the side, he starts pushing down towards the bottom.
Where do you play now, John?
Well, I could try on the third line.
Yeah,
there. Okay, now come back on 14, 11. Yeah.
There?
Well,
maybe not. 15-11?
Right there, yeah. And at this point, you're getting this battle going, and isn't black getting a little crowded down on the bottom? Not yet, but isn't that...
It, potentially, but white's not safe yet either.
Oh, yeah, white's still got some more work to do, but...
Do it!
Okay, we'll try a crosscut.
Connect.
And drop down one.
This is good, don't play this, ever.
Yeah.
Very bad idea. This is so much better. Okay, black plays there.
Ow. Well, at this point, I've run into this zero, but at this point I would connect the two pieces so they're not split. But basically, this is black to get a move ahead of you. So.
Yeah, that's the whole idea.
Yeah.
In fact, if you're going to connect, I think you have to connect that way.
We got to connect that way?
This is better, right, because then you can threaten to cut off the stone. This is better than this.
Okay.
This move almost always wrong.
Ryan, take the ladder.
That one's better. But if we're going to do that.
Now black's achieved his objective.
We have a little more.
Yeah. he's banged on the white stone in the middle of the right long enough and then come away with Fende so that he can carry out his attack.
Yeah, we're still actually a little bit weak over here. It's still a little dangerous. We need to have one more move, but. I don't think it's that hard to do. I think if we play one more move here just to guarantee ourselves an attack on white. Right now, is white going to play another move to protect this?
Well, I'm thinking at this point, black's got some weaknesses.
Okay, use them.
And one possibility is parry that one stone. So, I think on the other side.
I think this you want to ladder it, right?
Oh, yeah, right. That'll work.
Yeah, and actually, you know what? It's probably better for just black to do that and let you take that. And then play this.
But see, this is where I'm thinking white can come down and potentially split black.
Yes. But black can always be safe there. Very hard for black for white to take away all the eyes black has this point. Meanwhile, how does this look?
We're getting close to dead. Not scary.
Definitely not scary. Not scary at all. I'm not sure actually if Black should play those or this. Probably this. Maybe even that. Because that breaks the ladder, right? White runs. And then we play this. That gets exciting.
And now that white group doesn't have any eyes.
And so you start doing stuff like this. Black does this.
I'll push up,
You push up here. Black is all too happy to connect.
Well, if you were targeting the other direction,
that's super dangerous, though.
Yeah.
Oh, I see what you mean. Okay.
Yeah,
I wouldn't play this Atari immediately, I think. I want to play some moves that threaten the Atari in a more severe way. So if we're doing this as white, I'm not saying you play this directly, but isn't that better? Lean here, lean there, kind of out, right, because this threatens that, whereas pushing doesn't...
Well, yeah, but I'm thinking that if white wanders off, black immediately starts slabbering the two white stones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, black might just do things something like this, right?
Yeah.
And say, okay, I capture you, I capture you. Or capture them all together.
Yeah.
But it depends on what white does over here. Here's the moral of the story, all right? Let's take the stones off. How did this all happen? What was the concept?
Cut off the friend.
We're going to give it a new name. Leaning attack. May I have heard that expression before?
Yep.
A leaning attack. I think it's a Chinese proverb, might be Japanese too. But if you want to attack in the West, anyone knows the proverb?
Strike in the east.
Make noise in the east.
I think it's actually Sun Tzu.
Sun Tzu, the Art of War, yeah, okay. Yeah. That makes sense. So if we want to attack the west, make noise in the east. Very cool. Yeah. So this happens a lot in high level games.
Is it safe to say that you're taking advantage of the fact that usually when you cut the stone, both sides get stronger?
Yeah, basically. Yeah, we're just trying to gain some strength here. Okay. So those get really weak.
So, I don't know, Nick said that in the past, I'm pretty sure when you touch a stone, both sides end up getting stronger,
yeah. That's why you don't touch weak stones, right?
It seems like that effect is helping us attack elsewhere.
Yeah, because you can do this. And this happens all the time in single digit and dawn level and professional games where you might be watching the game and you're going, wait, there's a weak group over there. Why the hell are they fighting over this crap? You know, it's like, why did they play that move? They're actually in this involved meta game, right, this meta fight, where they're trying to decide the outcome of this battle to set up to see who gets to attack over here on the other side of the board, right? This is why, you know, high-level games are confusing to watch sometimes, right? Because they play moves like this. You're going, wait, there's the weak group. Why is he doing this? Well, this is a, you know, very simple, very clean example of this. I mean, this happens at a much higher level. But this move is to attack that.
So if white runs that out instead of protecting, do you immediately swallow that piece?
If we run out something like this. In this case, I think, because we already have a stone here, I think we can play a move or two. So, do you want to run out again, white? We're just trying to make sure black isn't get attacked over here.
Oh.
So I just want to add a stone to just make sure we're strong. If white runs out, then yeah, then we'll just say, okay. Where are you going?
So that's not any better for white.
Well, how do you feel about black's position over here?
Yeah.
Can you attack black anywhere?
Yeah.
Here?
Not
really. It's a lot harder to attack now. Yeah, we can take away the base for certain, right? We can play a move like that.
Let's attack the one black stone first.
You want to attack this one first? Ta-da, you attack it. You're done. Jeff might say, I'm attacking it again. Now what? Yeah, exactly. Okay, so this idea of a leaning attack. We're going to, next time we do the next attacking lecture, we're going to spend a lot more time developing leaning attacks. Okay, so this is sort of more what's to come. But this idea of, you know, the board is a whole bunch of different groups that all affect each other. Right, and you're sort of trying to play them off each other in an advantageous way for you. That's very much what Go is about, on a certain level of thinking. And this is a very, very clear example of that, with that move right there. Right, we're dividing the board into two, putting pressure over here, so we both get strong, so we can come back and attack this. Very, very Go type of thinking, very Go type of strategy. Okay, so leaning attacks. We learned a couple of new shapes, right, with these caps. All right, and white runs out, we take away the base. This is a weak point. Of course, if white only has one stone here, don't just blindly go, oh, there's a weak point there. You failed at Go. Right, was this a key point for white? Never, right, unless white has a stone over here, right? Now this is a key point for white. But if black has a stone here, knight's move, right? He's splitting elephant eye jumps.
Larry's going to be surprised.
Larry's going to be surprised? Does he play a lot of these little crawling moves?
Well, I don't know. He often sticks his head in, and one of the reasons he comes is to see what I'm learning.
Oh, I see.
He didn't show up.
I see. So it's a little competition.
These look to have more or less standard patterns in the nature of Joseki, but they're not localized the way that a Joseki.
Well, it can happen anywhere on the board. Yes.
Is there a natural way to study these in the sense of Joseki, or do you tend to have?
I think
a full board problem to give them context.
You know, well, that's the thing with attacking, right, is it kind of requires a full board context to most, because so much of attacking is about the leaning attack concept,
yeah,
right, that concept of leaning you. Certainly with this stuff, yes, you can sort of localize the shapes, and remember these shapes I'm trying to introduce, you know, I introduced a couple of them to you for sure today, that are really good to know. I think the Davies book, I think it's Attack and Defense, goes through a lot of these. So if you're more interested in just seeing sort of someone just stepping through a lot of these shapes, that's a good book. This one's a problem book, so if you just want to do the problems that involve these shapes, I think that's a great way to learn them, quite frankly. And unfortunately we speak English, and the English teaching methods don't have a whole lot of books just about shape. Just for whatever reason, that's still, it's getting a lot better. Especially, there's a couple new Korean series that are being translated to English, and there's a lot of Japanese Tsuji books that reinforce these sort of concepts. But, if you were living in or spoke in, Korean or Japanese or Chinese, there'd be a lot more resources available for you just to know these shapes as Joseki. So they do learn them as patterns of the shapes. Or we don't really have that. I mean, we have all these books here in our library, and, there's the Bozalich book on making good shape, right? As far as native English speakers, that's a great book, it certainly fills a giant hole in the spectrum of Go knowledge for English speakers. But then, the other books, there's this, which kind of deals with shape. And you have, Davies, which is great, but, feels outdated and is a little bit lacking in a lot, and it gets really wordy. It's not just shape recognition. It's like, here's some high-end theory, and here's this very specific game, and here's an example of it in play. Right? It's very well-rounded, but it doesn't feel like it's to the point enough often. And then we have books, we have like Ishida's and some of the Japanese authors, which are direct translations, but those are hit or miss and can depend a lot on the translation. So, know this one. Good job today, Eric.
Yeah, that was the new one to learn.
Show Larry the hard way.
not though, I think I can handle it properly. Yeah.
Well, that's how you practice, though, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so next week we'll be with the professional. I'll be here too. We'll videotape the whole thing. But if you've never met a professional Go player before, you should at least come for that. And she's going to do a full lesson for you guys.